Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Gaming Weekly.
Hi, how's it going? It's been a busy week. Steam is dead.
Yeah, didn't we say that before and like every week since, Lawrence?
Oh, yeah. But this time it's really real. How will Steam live without that car door closing division tech?
Wow. Speaking of slamming doors closed, Lawrence wanted to reclaim some gamer clout after shilling his heart out for Blizzard last week.
Yeah, but first, 20th Century Fox announced a new Alien game for mobile.
No.
Don't you have phones?
We get it. Mobile is the devil, but there's been a lot of misinformation getting tossed around about it, so we thought we'd step in and clear it up.
Yeah, I thought you said we were regaining some of that gamer clout this week, and we're already back to shilling, right, guys? Sorry, I'll do it. Mobile bad. Damn it. Sorry.
What?
Mobile dad.
Mobile dad. Come home.
Dad and bad.
Come home mobile.
Dad and bad are like the same thing to me. Here's what we know. So Alien Blackout is being developed by Foxnet Games, a division created in part due to the success of the mobile game, The Simpsons Tapped Out.
Okay, all right. And since apparently mobile games never come from just one team, Alien Blackout Development is also in collaboration with D3Go, who made Marvel Puzzle Quest, which is awesome.
We're still playing.
And Rival Games, who made Thief of Thieves Season 1, which is words. That game wasn't reviewed so well, but definitely has style?
Yeah, that's what I said about myself when I was in high school too. It didn't work then, it's not working now either.
All that really means is it's a bunch of teams who focus on easily digestible 2D mobile games. Just the A-team you'd want to follow up to a AAA PC forward survival horror game, right? This is the worst case scenario.
Yeah, anyway, tell us a little bit more about Blackout, Lawrence, please.
So according to the announcement, Blackout will feature 7 survival horror levels on a Weyland-Yutani space station because it's Alien. But here's where the gamer rage comes in. You play as Amanda Ripley, who is the main character from Alien Isolation.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah, that led a lot of reporters to connect the game directly to 2014's very awesome Alien Isolation by saying, the next Alien game is only on mobile. Other outlets are calling it a direct sequel to Isolation just because it features Amanda Ripley. Again, that's not really the case. Don't fall for that clickbait unless it's ours. Then you gotta click on it.
Well, I mean, still, look, we get it. We know how bad this looks. Alien Isolation was an awesome, spiritually authentic Alien game. We would love another one, but instead we get this sort of Five Nights ripoff mobile trash, right?
How dare you?
What?
Five Nights is a masterpiece, no matter what platform it's on.
Anyway, so yeah, watch out, Amanda. Aliens are coming. What? Maybe you could watch an ad to unlock anti-alien spray.
Oh.
Or recharge your anti-alien generator for just $2 more.
After 4 hours, you have enough energy to do the loader suit for 3 seconds.
How about you connect your Facebook account to unlock gold-plated flamethrowers? I don't know. Just no. Don't you have cell phones?
The thing is, it was first Diablo, and now it's this.
Yeah.
So people wanted Diablo, they got it, but not in the way they wanted it.
Yeah.
People wanted more Alien, they got it, but maybe not in the way they wanted it.
So yeah, it seems real bad. We still have no information on a proper follow-up to Alien Isolation, but 47, the PR company for Blackout, explicitly confirmed the game is not a sequel to Alien Isolation. They said, quote, Blackout is a standalone game that shares Amanda Ripley as a main character, but is not related to or a sequel of Isolation, which doesn't make any fucking sense.
Not really.
So we get that it's not a sequel to Isolation, but not related? It's the same character. Of course it's related. It sounds a bit like Bailout and Damage Control, but, you know, whatever. They can say whatever they want.
Well, what about that Tomb Raider game where Lara Croft teamed up with that Mayan guy and went isometric?
Yeah, I think that's lore. That plays into
Is that actual lore?
Who cares? Laura Croft?
Laura Croft. Anyway.
That's your joke book.
No, I'm not putting in my joke book. The only ray of hope here is that the existence of this game doesn't mean another actually good Alien game isn't coming, if that makes any sense.
Yeah. Specifically, Fox also announced an Alien massive online shooter in development at Cold Iron Studios. We're not exactly sure what that means, since Cold Iron hasn't released any other games, and other massive online shooters haven't really worked out well, at least recently.
Well, hold on. You remember Mag?
I know.
Do you remember Dust 514?
I think so.
PlanetSide 2 might be the best example of that sort of game we have to look toward, but it's difficult to imagine how that can mesh with a bunch of xenomorphs running around.
Yeah, unfortunately, a proper Alien Isolation sequel hasn't been greenlit yet, but that's not really due to the dreaded villainous mobile games. Rumors implied Alien Isolation developers Creative Assembly would start work on a sequel back in 2017, but Eurogamer reported those rumors were completely untrue. Plus, most of the devs who worked on Isolation aren't even there anymore, so that's a big oof.
You gotta check your facts.
We did.
No, I mean, not us. The real issue here, though, is that the original original Isolation just didn't sell that well. Sega described the game's performance as weak, which is coming from Sega. Only 2.11 million units sold in the first 6 months.
Okay, only 2.1 million. I guess that's a game.
No.
What? Game over.
No, don't say it.
Okay, fine. We'll just show Bill Paxton blasting that big old lube during that one line.
Some real pretty shit.
Perfect.
So, yeah, so 2.11 million sounds like a lot, but sadly, that won't blow the pants off any game publishers, especially when you've paid a dev staff of hundreds for years and years to make a game like Isolation. So why do that when you can just farm out a mobile clone to a staff of 20, roll the dice on winning the mobile lottery? Why not?
Yeah, for all the walking back 47 is trying to do regarding Alien Blackout, it sure sounds like they're just slapping an alien coat of paint on a Five Nights knockoff. Mm-hmm. Odds are Fox gave them permission to use Amanda Ripley because she's the most disposable at this point too.
Mm.
It's pretty easy to imagine a group of movie executives greenlighting a game with Amanda Ripley since she's a video game character.
But there is some hope, right, Lawrence?
Yeah, but not too much, really. If Blackout brings in a lot of cash and the Alien franchise works in gaming, they might greenlight a proper sequel to Isolation. Or they'll just crank out mobile games every 6 months, goddammit. There's been a lot of times where publishers try to do a big blowout AAA game, and if they don't get loads and loads of cash, they just get scared away from the proposition entirely. It sounds like that's what's happening with Fox and Alien. They tried Colonial Marines, they tried Isolation. Neither one of them seemed to really hit all that much, so they may just be done with it.
I'm the exact same way with lottery tickets.
Oh yeah?
I'll scratch off the first number. If it's not right, and I haven't already won the jackpot, I just throw the whole ticket away.
I think this is just a good moment for people who own IPs to realize that the time of Alien and Predator is done, and we move on to Highlander.
Okay.
Speaking of abandoning all hope, Steam is doomed. Doomed.
Are you sure you're not being overly dramatic?
Doomed. Okay. Yeah, maybe a little. But Epic Games has announced that they are partnering with Ubisoft to bring Tom Clancy's The Division 2 to the Epic Games Store instead of Steam.
There's an Epic Games Store? What do they think of next? It's currently pre-orderable on epicgames.com, which guarantees access to the game's private beta, but it's also available on the Ubisoft store when the game's actually out.
Tell us a little bit more about that big ol' press release, Lawrence.
So here's a fun quote for you. Ubisoft and Epic will work to integrate key components of Ubisoft's Uplay and Epic's online services to provide gamers from both ecosystems with more seamless social features and interoperability.
What?
Which probably means that they'll just function like Steam. You buy it from Epic, it kicks you over to Uplay, you got to register it there. It's really annoying, but then you get to play your game.
They also said that the two companies will partner on additional select titles to be announced during the coming year. So probably, you know, Assassin's Creed.
Or Skull and Bones, if that ever comes out.
Or Anno 1800.
You can't say that.
Is
okay?
It?
You can't say that.
Is that
no,
bad?
No, this is the internet. You're not allowed to say the A word.
I'm into Ano.
Since Epic launched the Epic Games Store, they really haven't had much trouble attracting indies, but getting more AAA publishers on board is harder when Steam is so goddamn popular.
Yeah, please remember that there are over 125 million active Steam accounts. So if Steam were a country, it would be the 10th biggest in the entire world.
Obviously, that means Ubisoft could potentially lose sales, and 125 million accounts won't see their games there. But Epic promises to take a way smaller revenue cut from sales than Steam does.
Yeah, Epic takes 12% instead of Steam's, honestly, kind of absurd 30%.
Otherwise, how would the games get to you? How would they get there, Adam, if it wasn't for Steam?
But by the most average-based Steam sales math we could figure out, for the same amount of sales, the original Division would have made Ubisoft almost $60 million more on Epic Store than on Steam. So it's not a small amount.
Yeah, either way, the user base isn't there yet, but the profits are. The gamers are pretty likely to follow, but we wanted to know what some actual developers think of the changes.
Awaiting responses.
And we will await their responses.
Call us, developers. I think we have someone on the line. Yes? Lawrence, are you a developer?
I am, and I like money!
All right, there it is. Well, you should have picked a different career path because it's the executives that are getting paid.
And hey, speaking of reclaiming lost value, Lawrence is here with a follow-up to last week's corporate shill fest.
Yeah, so we got a lot of dislikes on our last video. So after I got done drawing my blackout curtains and having a good cry, I looked into it further. I mean, I typically, you know, unlike Blizzard, we actually listened to our audience. A lot of people complained that we didn't appropriately represent people's gripes with Blizzard, and they were right. We were reporting on the business side of it, which shockingly most people don't give a fuck about. So I put out the call on social media to get people's firsthand accountings of their issues with current Blizzard products, and a ton of people responded. over 100, I think. I spent a good 4 hours reading some very impassioned DMs yesterday, so I tried to compile that all into a consensus of complaints on Blizzard's various games, so I'll get into that right now. So for Overwatch, makes a lot of sense. People complain there's no new events, which there haven't been for a while. New characters are buggy and they upset the meta. I get it. Story has been frustrating people for a while. It's just this drip feed of like comics and little bits that don't go anywhere or deliver any actual conclusions. New characters have low skill ceilings. This was an interesting complaint. A lot of character balance has been removing like specialized roles for characters. So with new characters like Wrecking Ball and Brigitte, they complain that these are too multi-role. They become necessary picks, which means it destroys the meta and the fun of a lot of different characters. They say balance patches hit too often, which makes the game hard to get used to or develop new meta, and that players are way too toxic, that Blizzard could probably do a better job of enforcing reporting or use role select instead of just looking for group to make sure that players don't switch to DPS when they don't get their way. I think the biggest problem as it relates to Blizzard as a company is a lot of people perceive that with Overwatch, they've moved a lot of development effort onto the Overwatch League, which makes sense. Blizzard, I think, has put a lot of money into Overwatch League, and I think they have yet to see any of it come back. So they're probably doubling down, trying to extract money out of that initiative. It's a pretty classic big corporation move. So I can see how that would lead to some concern for the future of Blizzard based on the operation there. Diablo, surprisingly, most people were cool with Immortal. They were disappointed with the announcement, but they're okay with it coming out. So that was kind of interesting to read. With Hearthstone, people are mostly upset that the last few expansions didn't upset the game mechanic at all. It was just kind of more of the same. Saw some complaints that there are cards that have actual RNG on them now, which sucks. I mean, you have the randomness of the draw on top of randomness on individual cards. Yeah. With Heroes of the Storm, a lot of people were really upset at how the cancellation of HGC was done, namely that there wasn't any communication with anyone in the community, which is kind of a running trend. StarCraft 2, shockingly, a lot of people are okay with. Well, it's a dead game, so whoever's actually still involved with that community was okay with it. Personally, I still watch it. This year's WCS was really great, so no complaints there. World of Warcraft. Now, this is the big one. This is the one that I think has a lot of people super worried about a grand sea change in the way Blizzard operates. Battle for Azeroth has a lot of problems, and I read a lot of people saying the same stuff, and then when Battle for Azeroth did come out, everyone was like, no, we hated this in the beta. It's still here. Why didn't Blizzard listen to us or change any of this?
Just not to interrupt, but what year did World of Warcraft come out?
Yeah, it's about 15 years old.
Okay. All right, go ahead.
So, yes, we're entering what could be considered the deep twilight years for World of Warcraft. It's hard to imagine any other game that's been active for this long. So it's getting a little weird, but here's the problem. People really like Legion. They were really okay with it. A lot of the improvements made there were apparently rolled back, and rolled back in concerning ways. Namely that now a lot of the progress is time-gated, so you cannot just sit down and play the game, which seems like a trick to reinforce monthly active users. You have to like log out, log back in. Certain world events only happen at certain times of the day. So it's almost like Farmville shittiness, where to progress and see all the game's content, you have to come back at certain times as opposed to just playing the game. So all of this wrapped together, it really does feel like Blizzard is sort of doing the shitty development thing where they release an unfinished product and focus their efforts on microtransactions and little hooks that they can pull to get people playing as opposed to just making a product. I get it. It actually makes a lot of sense after reading a lot of those complaints stacking up against the recent Blizzard news, how those things combined could also make people think that Blizzard is starting down a very dark path. There was one Reddit thread that I think summarized it very well when it comes to World of Warcraft. Quote, the game we play today is not a game at all. Instead, World of Warcraft is a data gathering index of daily user actions and patterns. It's a research tool to help scummy marketing people decide what to put on sale, how much to charge for a Fox mount, or which adverts to fill the game launcher with. You no longer see me as a player, but instead as a payer. It's from a Reddit post, which I think summarizes a lot of the concerns people have with World of Warcraft, which I think then parlays into some of the headlines we've seen, which give people a lot of concern about Blizzard. I can see the narrative forming from a World of Warcraft point of view, and I totally get that. I think being a more casual consumer of Blizzard products, especially given Overwatch, how it's formatted and how it's been executed, maybe not so much in the last 6 months or so, given the perceived shift to Overwatch League. But yeah, I can say at least that I've had my mind changed a little bit, and I can understand concern a lot more from the consumer perspective now than just the business perspective. From the business perspective, I think it's still business as usual there. I think they've still got projects in development that are still sort of classic Blizzard mentality that aren't so much focused on, you know, microtransactions or forcing people to log back in every day to get their shiny gold coins. Yeah, we'll see. We'll see. I think this year's BlizzCon is going to be either proof of life or we can write them off forever.
All right. That's a lot to take in, but that I appreciate you going through the effort of taking other people's opinions, considering them against your own, and
Yeah, you didn't even touch on why they make my favorite character in Overwatch gay.
So that's interesting. I did get a lot of reactions saying, why'd they make Soldier gay? It's kind of like they slapped a gay band-aid on some community woes, and I can definitely see how it comes across that way. However, Blizzard didn't make him gay because he was never heterosexual to begin with. There was never anything in the game saying, this dude is a woman fucking man's man. there were hints. People didn't read into them because, kind of like myself, you just assume that someone's heterosexual unless something else is said. So the timing of it is suspect, but I give the Overwatch devs the benefit of the doubt here. I think Soldier was always homosexual or bi. It just didn't put a pin in it.
I was going to say, the game has a giant talking ape. The least of my concerns is the sexual orientation of any of the characters I'm playing as, because hey, it's a video game.
Well, there was also the photograph that is the reference point for everything was also in the same Overwatch comic that Tracer was, I don't know if outed is the right word, but revealed to be a lesbian in too. I don't know. It's all there.
My hope it was sort of like a pseudo Battlestar Galactica future where we just put away any sort of sexuality stamp on anything. You fuck whatever you want, you be with whoever you want to be. It's Overwatch. It's the future, and it's perfect.
I mean, you can understand though, right? If somebody fucks up and they're like, you can't hate me because I'm gay. Like, it's not a good look, but I don't think that's the case here.
No, I don't think so. I don't know. If anything, my only gripe with Overwatch really is the lack of lore and sort of the expanded universe videos that they've been talking about for years and we've seen bits of. I thought we'd have an Overwatch show by now, but that kind of bums me out because I feel like Overwatch is rich of that lore, but as a fan, I'm kind of checked out. I haven't played Overwatch in a while, so.
Overwatch is over 2 years old at this point. That's kind of the weird concept that people have, that a good game will grow and be playable forever. I don't know where that mentality came from, but I don't think that's intended. It's just known that games will get an audience and that audience will dwindle over time. So Blizzard needs new products. I think that's the big thing, and they don't have any, aside from Warcraft 3 Reforged.
And with that, we're about done here for this episode of Gaming Weekly. Thank you so much for watching. Lawrence, thanks for Skyping in.
I didn't remember how hard it was to talk when I hear myself echoing in my own ears, but it's a blast of nostalgia. I love it.
You've grown weak, Lawrence, just like Duncan MacLeod grew weak after the events of Highlander 2.
For more Highlander news, tune in to Gaming Weekly here every week. We'll see you on the battlefield of the Highlands.
Nice.
You need to chill out, guys. What's your problem?
Me?
Yes, you.
Oh, all right. I mean, that's fair. We'll also be talking about some of our favorite games from 2018. That's last year. And what we think people kind of missed out on. But first, let's talk about this Blizzard story.
Yeah, since Diablo Immortal was controversially revealed back in November, bloggers and tube lords have been decrying